Hi all, welcome to Mains Maxima. In this session of ethics, we will be discussing three questions. The first question is pertinent to the international ethics part of the syllabus. The second question is pertinent to the role of civil services in bringing good governance part of the syllabus. And the third question is related with the law of peoples postulated by John Rawls. Let's go to the first question. The question is, presently, international organizations carry with them structural deformities. Hence, it compels operational challenges. Discuss. So what is the importance of proper functioning of international organization? International organization, they strive to bring in order in the international arena. So international organizations are important in this aspect. And ethics is nothing but an external order imposed on the system. So international ethics also becomes important in this aspect. What happens if there is no order in international arena? It leads to tyranny. For every misdeed of a tyrant, a vulnerable person or a vulnerable nation is being bothered. This disturbs the peace and tranquility of the international arena. For this purpose, bringing in ethics in international relations, international organization becomes more imperative. Let's move to the model answer of this question. International organization in the contemporary period, they are facing the challenge of structural deformities. The structural deformities come in different shape. Let's see what are the structural deformities being faced by the international organizations. The first one is over dependence on one country. That is, after the fall of USSR, the international organization have moved towards an unipolar structure, that is towards USA. USA being the largest economy, they have the money power, they have the muscle power, because most of the votes in international fora are based on proportionality. So because of their financial power, they have muscle power to take decisions on, to influence the decisions of international bodies. So the first structural deformity is over dependence on one country. And the second one is lack of financial autonomy. Most of the international organization, they are dependent upon the contribution made by the developed countries. And whenever there is conflict of opinion, conflict of interest between the international organization and the developed country, they stop their contribution. So this affects the financial autonomy of the international organization. For example, we consider the case of UNESCO. USA has stopped funding UNESCO after the UNESCO listing Israeli Jewish sites as an Islamic sites in its report. And the third aspect is about the developed nation threatening the affirmative action for the selfish needs. Like USA is threatening the dialogue process happening in WTO in order to create favor for their own companies. And in UNFCCC regarding climate change, USA has backed out of the Paris deal. This hampers the affirmative action towards curtailing climate change in world. Also, the major problem in international organizations are the skewed power distribution. The power distribution is not equal. This creates inequality of power distribution in international organizations. So because of this, there are blocks formed by different countries. These blocks act as an external balancing agent for like-minded countries. These actions hamper the outcomes in international plenaries. Apart from this, there are also increasing number of regional bodies, which are also known as minilateral organizations. These minilateral organization regional bodies, they obstruct the global order. They create challenges to the global order. Example, ASEAN, Trans-Pacific Partnership and BRICS. Apart from the structural challenges, there are also some operational challenges. The actions of international bodies are inclined towards satiating the highest fund provider. Like if we consider India is providing highest fund to SAARC, then the decisions of the SAARC should be based on India's opinion. This is not the order prescribed by the ethical and moral values. As we discussed earlier, the disruption created by power blocks have a great impact on the healthy functioning of international organization. Equality is the main theme on which the international organization should function on. So let's consider the case of United Nations Security Council, where most of the larger democracies, populous countries and larger economies are not represented. For example, India and Brazil are not being represented in UN Security Council as permanent member. But when these countries try to get into UNSC permanent seat, there are other countries who challenge their entry into UNSC. So this power politics, it reduces the affirmative actions of the international bodies. If we consider the present trend of trade wars, trade wars or the ways of showing revenge. Because of this revenge, with this revenge, these countries try to reconciliate. And revenge and reconciliation, they are a process happening in the international fora in the guise of trade wars. So US is imposing tariffs on China, and because of that, they want China to reconcile with US. But revenge and reconciliation are equally balanced by an external balancing force known as justice. Without justice, the revenge and reconciliation can be counterbalanced only by an external balance provided by the justice. And the international organization can survive only when justice is prevailing in the international organization, because justice is fairness. Removing structural deformities in international organization will bring in justice to the international organization, and this will help in restricting the operational antimonies present in the international organizations today. The second question is related with bureaucracy, and especially how valid is Weber's theory of bureaucracy in this modern 21st century democratic society. So, as I mentioned earlier, introduction, we can start by defining the terms given in the question, or we can introduce a quotes given by any leaders or important personalities. So, for this particular question, we can start by providing a quote given by President Woodrow Wilson. Administration is the most obvious part of governance. It is the government in action. It is the executive, the operative, and the most visible side of the government. I repeat, administration is the most obvious part of governance. It is the government in action. It is the executive, the operative, and the most visible side of the government. So what is the role of bureaucracy in providing efficient administration? Bureaucracy is the link between the state and the people. Bureaucracy acts as a receiver from the people's end, and they act as the givers from the state's end. So the objective of the state and its citizens are achieved through the instrument of bureaucracy. Another philosopher, Hegel, says that bureaucracy is devoted to the common good of the people, and they act for the betterment and welfare of the citizens. I repeat, Hegel says that bureaucracy is devoted to the common good of the people, and they act for the betterment and welfare of the citizens. So the bureaucracy acting between public and the state. Bureaucracy act as an instrument of administration in the society. So what we mentioned earlier was the textbook definition of bureaucracy. But in the modern complex world, in the present postmodern era, there are several instances in which, during which, the institution of bureaucracy has deviated from its stipulated path of ideal nature and utopian nature. And instead of acting for the public interest, the deviation that resulted in bureaucracy acting for its own self-interest. Max Weber, the proponent of ideal rational bureaucratic system, has given few parameters which defines the ideal type of bureaucracy. What are the parameters? The first parameter is hierarchy. Hierarchy is nothing but a formal structure of well-defined authority with varying powers and varying responsibilities. For example, we have a collector, sub-collector, and a deputy collector in a district administration. This forms a hierarchy. Apart from this, the second point is division of labor. What is division of labor? Division of labor is nothing but segregation of roles, a segregation of functions to be performed by the members of the bureaucracy. Let's consider the example of a cabinet secretary and the departmental secretaries. Departmental secretaries, they have their roles limited to their specific department, whereas the cabinet secretaries oversees the complete functioning of other secretaries of department. So this is division of labor. The third point is rules. Any bureaucracy is bound by rules and regulations. The fourth point is impersonality. Impersonality can be defined as absence or the need for individual's personal desire. That is, absence of the need for personal desires. Any bureaucrat, they should not use their job, they should not earn for personal desires while holding that job. Their ultimate aim should be to do the duty allotted to them in that particular role. Fifth aspect is about official records. Whatever the work being done has to be recorded, and it has to be properly maintained. And the last aspect mentioned by Max Weber is differentiation of public and private ends. These six principles, they form the important characteristics of the ideal rational bureaucratic setup proposed by Max Weber. As we mentioned earlier, Max Weber has mentioned impersonality as an important attribute for a proper bureaucratic setup, for an ideal bureaucratic setup. So, what happens when impersonality seeps in? Impersonality is seeping in, it creates a rule-based rational control. When rule-based rational control comes in, emotion and empathy goes away. The officer becomes a machine. So, he is bound by rules, he acts like a robot, he gets in command, executes the command. So he loses his emotion and empathy, he loses his emotion intelligence. This unfettered bureaucracy is a threat to individual freedom, says Max Weber. The real nature of the bureaucratic machinery in this present 21st century, it manifestly differs from the ideal type proposed by Max Weber. The most important aspect in answering the questions is understanding the tail word. Here, the tail word in this question was critically. Whenever the word critically is given, we have to analyze, we have to criticize the concept. So, in this question, we should mention how deviant is the present bureaucratic setup to comparing to the ideal setup provided by Max Weber. So, we'll discuss the challenges. What is the first challenge? The bureaucracy is unresponsive to popular demand and desires. So, in the present postmodern world, as particular to India, with the introduction of globalization, liberalization, the market is moving in a faster pace, but the bureaucracy is moving in a slow pace. This has made the bureaucratic setup to become unresponsive to public demand and desires. The second challenge is related with corruption. Corruption can be defined as an government abetted theft. Corruption can be defined as an theft, organized theft done by the bureaucratic setup in the country. So the level of corruption in India is so deep that India stands 108th in among 180 countries in the report given by Transparency International. Impartiality and honesty are the main values to be nurtured by a bureaucratic civil servant. But in the present world, these values have been eroding, and because of this, the corruption has seeped into the bureaucratic setup, completely deviating from the ideal type proposed by Max Weber. So, as we discussed earlier, introducing a rules-based system vehemently, introducing impersonality, this has made a system a line-following robot. A line-following robot follows a line using its light sensor. The present bureaucratic setup, it follows the rules blindly without giving any space for proactive governance. This has led to red tapeism or over-formalism. For example, we may consider, because of this being low on ethical values and rigid bureaucracy, weak enforcement mechanism, this has pushed down the India's rank and ease of doing business rank worldwide. Any democratic state is based on social contract. It is a social contract between the citizens and the state or the executive. So, citizens pay tax to avail services from the state. It is the role and the duty of the state to provide them with the proper services. But due to this self-perpetuating bureaucracy, the services are not received by the people in a proper way. This is another aspect of deviation from Max Weber's ideal bureaucratic policy. The most Indian aspect of deviating bureaucratic setup is the conflict between the permanent executive and the political executive. The political executives, say the ministers, they are responsible to the public in a democratic setup. Only the political executive is accountable to the public. So, this reduces the accountability as far as bureaucrats are concerned. Since the bureaucrats are not accountable to the public, they indulge in self-aggrandizement. This induces corruption. Since they are not accountable to the public, they breed in greed and they lack honesty. These two factors lead to corruption. Bureaucracy is like a long truck having 100 wheels. What happens when each wheel is moving in a different direction? Lack of correlation will jam the functioning of a truck. So the same happens to the bureaucracy. When the number of departments, they become a mini empire by themselves, or the process of departmentalization and the mini empire creation, this moves the governance in different direction. It pushes in different direction. This makes the governance, this makes the bureaucratic functioning to halt. So this is another aspect of deviation from Weber's theory of bureaucracy. The present, the modern day bureaucracy is regressive in nature. It is not moving forward. It wants to stay in its own silo of comfort, and they are not ready to come out of their comfort zone and to be proactive. This is mainly because the bureaucracy loves tradition and it stands for conservatism. And the last aspect of deviation is specialization. Most of the civil servants, most of the bureaucrats of the present day, they are from different educational backgrounds. They have a proper ground level experience by managing the administration of a district. But when they move upwards, when they reach the place of policy making level, say a joint secretary in the central government, they lack a proper specialized knowledge in the particular field they are posted in, particular department they are posted in. This hampers the good governance in the country. In order to avoid this, second ARC, Second Administrative Reforms Commission in 2004 had recommended for lateral entry in civil services. Now the government has introduced the lateral entry in civil services to improve specialization in the bureaucracy. So in this model answer, we have discussed the characteristics of ideal rational bureaucracy proposed by Max Weber. So that now we have more deviation from the bureaucratic definition, bureaucratic setup given by Max Weber. Can we move away from the Weberian bureaucratic setup? No, it is not possible. Because in spite of dysfunctions, a welfare state cannot boycott Weberian bureaucracy. Because some of the functions of the welfare state and the development programs cannot be completed without bureaucracy, and people look to bureaucracy for their day-to-day requirements. Bureaucracy is still remaining the steel frame on which the building of governance is built upon. So bureaucracy, the Weberian bureaucracy, cannot be avoided. Redundancy in any organization or any setup is not going to augur well for that setup. This is also true for bureaucracy. Weberian bureaucracy has important elements to achieve the developmental goals of the society. Proper evolution, proper introspection, and proper changes introduced time to time will improve the efficiency of bureaucracy. The next question is related with law of peoples proposed by American philosopher John Rawls. What is this law of peoples all about? And what is it necessary to have a question on law of peoples? Last year, and UPSC every year has a habit of asking a question about a philosopher thinker. And last year they asked about the John Rawls theory of social justice. And this John Rawls law of peoples is related with international relations and the ethics of international relations. So now we have seen many problems happening in the international arena. It becomes important to know about ethics of international relations proposed by John Rawls. What is this law of peoples all about? The law of peoples discusses about how far the international toleration by a liberal society is expected to extend. So it is about toleration in international relations. It is about toleration between different communities. This is what law of peoples is all about. Let's move to the model answer. The law of peoples is work of American philosopher John Rawls in international relation. In this, the peoples here means the actors in society of peoples. How we have a citizens in a domestic society, we have peoples in society of peoples. So by law of peoples, he means, John Rawls means, a particular political conception of right and justice that applies to the principles and norms of international law and practice. I repeat, law of peoples is a particular conception of right and justice that applies to the principles and norms of international law and practice. The states mentioned by the peoples mentioned by John Rawls is nothing but a group of citizens, a group of homogeneous people. And John Rawls says that the discussions, the deliberations based on laws of people would start from a particular point called original position. What is this original position? The original position discusses, the original position is about the rules of interaction between the representatives of peoples. And this original position is an hypothetical arrangement where representatives of the peoples, the representative of the peoples are nothing but representatives of a homogeneous popular unit. And these representatives, they meet and they discuss together to determine the principles that will govern their interaction. The principles that has come out of this interaction makes the content of the law of peoples. Best example would be the deliberation that happened in the recent fourth BIMSTEC conference in Kathmandu. The leaders, they sat together and they decided the framework and they have decided that the framework, the representatives of the peoples, here the representative of the people means the leader of a nation. A nation is a peoples. So the leaders of the nation, that is the representative of the peoples, they sat together, they interacted, and based on that interaction, they have decided to create a framework of rules by 2019. This is an example for this original position mentioned by John Rawls in his Law of Peoples. The formulation of laws of people is based on 8 principles. What are the 8 principles? The first principle speaking about sovereignty of peoples. That is, peoples are independent and their freedom and independence has to be respected by other peoples. This defines the sovereignty. The second principle is the peoples are equal and they are parties to their own agreements. The third point is about their right to war. John Rawls has not, the law of peoples does not allow the peoples to have a right of war, but they have been given with the right to self-defend. The next principle is about non-intervention. The law states that the peoples should maintain the duty of non-intervention. The people should not interfere in the working and functioning of the other peoples. For example, we have Panchsheel and Naam. The next principle is the peoples has to observe treaties and undertakings. The sixth principle is that if at all peoples are engaging in a war for the sake of self-defense, only a war is allowed. If at all they are engaging in a war, they should follow certain rules and regulations. The seventh principle is that the peoples have to honor the basic human rights. Every individual member of peoples should enjoy their basic human rights. And the last principle on which this laws of people is built upon is that every peoples have a duty to save, to assist the other peoples living in abject social and political conditions. For example, for this would be the responsibility to protect program of UN. This responsibility to protect program can be attributed, can be compared with the 8th principle of laws of people. The present global arena is facing a situation in which the sovereignty of the countries is facing a challenge in both economical and political front. Equality and justice based order is need of the hour to protect the prevailing global system and in order to protect the prevailing order in the global arena. Thank you.